knew if we waited just long enough. Good morning.
Good morning.
Ma?
What?
Come on.
I'm not done.
Well, she's the pianist, and so...
Kind of need her.
Where's the, oh, there it is. Okay. All right. Announcements. Coming events. Next Sunday is Easter. Do not miss this one. Okay? Today is Palm Sunday, and next week we are going to have breakfast. Correct? Somebody's been telling you that. I'm pretty sure we talked about this before, but we are having breakfast before Easter service next week, so please
what
be here
time?
For that too. Huh? It doesn't say. This says
9:45.
See? There you go.
Thanks, Mom.
May 8th is Mother's Day. The day after that, May 9th, will be the board meetings for, I'm assuming, all of us that are on the boards.
The board meeting tomorrow night.
That would be tomorrow night.
That's your reminder, Tim.
Yeah, I'm talking about in May, see? I said May 8th and then May 9th. I didn't say anything about tomorrow night. I said that's the board meeting. That's in May. I already know about the one tomorrow. May 15th, be ready for the beach. We're going to have hot dogs after church. And then a special spot Father's Day breakfast, which will also be his birthday breakfast. And unfortunately, I will not be here to attend, so I apologize for that. But that being said, there's your announcements.
Nope.
Uh-oh.
One more. After the dedication today, there will be cake. After church today, there will be cake downstairs to celebrate Carson's dedication.
Well, is the sermon before or after the dedication? Well, then maybe we should eat first. No, I'm just kidding. After the service today, they're going to have cake in honor of the dedication of our new friend. So, that being said, please walk across the aisle. Tell someone you love.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
patient at the hospital says to the another patient, patient two, why did you run away from the operating table? Well, the nurse was repeatedly saying, don't get nervous, don't be afraid, be strong, this is a small operation only, things like that. So what was wrong with that? Why were you so afraid? She was talking to the surgeon. God said, phew, I just created a 24-hour period of alternating light and darkness of earth. The angel said, what are you going to do now? And God said, call it a day. Come on, man. These were handed to me. It's not my fault. One afternoon, a man came home from work to find total mayhem in his house. His three children were outside, still in their pajamas, playing in the mud, with empty food boxes and wrappers thrown all about the front yard. The door to his wife's car was wide open, and so was the front door to the house. Proceeding into the entry, he found an even bigger mess. A lamp had been knocked over. A throw rug was wadded up against one wall. In the front room, the TV was blaring a cartoon channel, and the family room was strewn with toys and various items of clothing. In the kitchen, dishes filled the sink. Breakfast food was spilled on the counter, dog food was spilled on the floor, and broken glass lay under the table. And a small pile of sand lay piled up by the back door. He quickly headed up the stairs, stepping over toys and other piles of clothes, looking for his wife. He was worried that she might be ill or worse. He found her lounging in the bedroom, still in her pajamas, reading a novel. She smiled, looked up at him, and asked how his day went. He looked at her bewildered and asked, what happened here today? She again smiled and answered, you know, every day when you come home from work and ask me what in the world did I do today? He said, yeah. Well, today I didn't do it. I've told that one before. I remember that. That's a funny joke, too. All right. Well, today is Palm Sunday, and I want you to imagine what Jesus probably felt like when he's walking through this town and everybody's throwing palms down. We're all cheering. We're all glad he's here. And on a dime, within the week, every one of those people hated him for nothing. And he went. He knew it was going to happen, and he came anyway. So we're going to bear that in mind while we sing today. Let's stand and sing Hosanna, loud Hosanna.
I'm time to time, we are privileged to enter into our family a new person, a real life person. We're going to ask that Tony and Carson and Jared would come to the front. And Carson. Babies are cool. And from a grandpa standpoint, it's so nice when we can give them back. This is Carson. This is Tony. And this is Jared. Mama and Daddy. You probably figured that out. Scripture talks about in the New Testament particularly, but in the Old also. It tells that we should let the little children come unto Jesus. But it's more than letting them come to Jesus. It's bringing them to Jesus. In Ephesians chapter 6, it tells the parents to raise our children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Nurture and structure. Teaching and training them. In Proverbs, it tells us in chapter 22, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he won't depart from it. There's a lot of truth in all of those scriptures. But today, these parents are dedicating this young man in saying, and actually it is a parental dedication, that they have decided to nurture him and love him and bring him up in the admonition and nurture of the Word of God. That's their dedication of this young man, that he would become the man that God wants him. He doesn't like me. So I'd like to pray with you, pray over them. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these two and for now the third, the member of the family. We ask that you would bless them as they seek to give guidance and direction, that your Holy Spirit would fill their decisions, and that this young man would grow into the man that God wants him to be. And we dedicate ourselves, this family, this child, for your glory and honor, now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen. To remember this day, we give you a certificate. There will be a small Bible coming that we've ordered. Just didn't get here on time. And we will give that to you another day. But we want you to know. Now, you probably haven't seen him much except being carried around just like this. We're going to stand and sing Jesus Loves Me while they take and present Carson to you.
Besides Marilyn, know of Ray Overholt? This pastor? Okay. Well, this song I think is a little more meaningful if you know a little bit about Ray Overholt. I never met the man, but Marilyn has. He was raised on a farm near Middleville. Dad bought him a guitar when he was 10, and he taught himself to play, started singing, and started writing songs. He played in honky-tonks and bars as he grew older, drank heavily, and had a pretty rough life. But it led to his talent led to his becoming Grand Rapids Singing Cowboy. He had got his own band, a TV show called Ray's Roundup on Wood TV in the 40s and 50s. But he became very unhappy with his life. And he had married a woman named Millie, who was a pianist and accompanied him sometimes. And he told his wife he wanted to clean up his life. So he started Bible study. And he was particularly moved by Matthew 26, especially verse 48. And though still not a believer, but based on what he discovered in the Bible, he decided he wanted to write a gospel song. He actually started it one night while he was playing at a dance hall in Battle Creek. He wrote the first verse, he threw it in the guitar case, left it there for quite some time. But he was a musician, and people knew him, and this little country church invited him to come and sing at their service. And he didn't know what this church, why they wanted a non-believer to come and sing. But he agreed to do it. And the only gospel song he knew was the one he wrote. So he sang it. The name of it was 10,000 Angels. And that service had a minister that gave a very powerful sermon, kind of like our pastor here. And that combined with Ray singing his own song gave him the conviction to finally give his life to Christ. And he knelt down at that service and did that. His song was published in 1958. It was made kind of famous by Loretta Lynn, but many other country bluegrass artists have sung it. It's kind of known around the world in some areas. So that's the name of the song I'm going to sing this morning. Sometimes around Easter we get caught up with Easter bunnies and spring and all of that, but this song really leads up to Good Friday. They bound the hands of Jesus in the garden where he prayed. They led him through the streets in shame. They spat upon the Savior, so pure and free from sin. They said, crucify him, he's to blame. He could have called the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. Upon the head of Jesus, they placed a crown of thorns. They laughed and said, behold the King. They struck him, and they cursed him, and mocked his holy name. And all alone, he suffered everything. He could have called 10,000 angels. they nailed him to the cross. His mother stood nearby. He said, "Woman, behold thy son." He cried, "I thirst for water," but they gave him none to drink. Then the sinful work of man was done. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. To the howling mob he yielded, and did not for mercy cry. He bore the cross of shame alone. And as he cried, "It's finished," he gave himself to die. Salvation's wondrous plan was done. He could have called angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. But he died alone for you and me.
On the back of your bulletin, there's a place for you to write prayer requests. Sandy is still home, suffering the effects of COVID.
You got the tail end. She doesn't have COVID no more. It's just the side effects that
okay.
She has no tail.
So write Sandy's name in. Well, that's good. You know, from our perspective for today, if she were here, she wouldn't eat much cake. Carlos, obviously, is not here today. He, as you know, he fell 2 weeks ago. He's been in ICU for the last week. And we continue to pray for Carlos as he recovers. Sandy and Sherry both have issues with breathing, and it was very difficult for them to get here, so we pray for them. Are there other requests that I have not spoken? Carol, of course. Thank you. Jordan brought her grandpa to church today. Isn't that nice? Thank you so much for bringing Dave. We appreciate Dave. And we miss you when you're not here. So we want to continue to pray for Carol. She also fell, struggling with the results of falling. So let's pray for Carol. Put those requests on those lines. That's why the lines are there for you to write in. Are there any other requests that we need to... Harold?
Not a request, but I just wondered if anybody's got an update on Pat and Ray.
Pat and Ray, yes. I saw them a week ago, and they're still recovering, very much afraid. They're in their 90s now. Very much afraid of contracting any outside infections of any kind, not just COVID. They are pretty much secluded. They order shipped and get their groceries delivered. About the only time they go out is when they're going to the doctor. They watch us. Hi, Ray. Hi. And Pat. And so that's an update for you on that. Okay. Well, let's go to prayer real quickly. Father God, as always, as we enter through these doors, we bring with us the burdens of our life, the stories of the back stories, the troubles that we share, and we come. And Lord, we love our family. And it's fun to laugh. It's precious to share. And it gives us hope that somebody cares, even when they don't know what's troubling us. We hold before you these obvious requests for health issues of all of our folks, whether it's flu, COVID, other ailments, cancer, falls, pulled muscles, broken bones. Father, we lay them before you and ask that you would heal. Especially touch Carlos today. Help him to be able to breathe and get air to his lungs. Lord, we thank you that you hear our prayers and answer them in accordance with your will, that we, for our good and for your glory. So we ask your presence with us this morning as we open the Word of God, that you would teach us perhaps things we don't even know and have not heard. But for those things we have heard and understand, let us apply them into our life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. It's Palm Sunday. It is the spectacular event. And while we could read for you the triumphal entry from the Gospel of Luke, where it says, and Jesus said this, he went ahead up to Jerusalem as he approached. He sent disciples ahead and go get a colt. And they did, a donkey. And we could read that story, and we will in just a moment. But you have to understand this time of the year and what it means in the life of the Israeli nation. This journey that Jesus was taking was the highlight of their year. I was thinking, how in the world did Jesus get a crowd? Well, it's pretty simple. Have you ever gone out on Sternberg Road on the day before Christmas, the 24th, and if you're heading east on Sternberg and you want to turn into the mall, have you ever seen that traffic jam? They're lined up all the way back to the freeway, 3-4 lanes deep. It is chaos. And then try to find a place to park. The Passover is the Jewish Christmas at that time. It was the best time of the year. It was a feast that was born in celebration of another parallel to Jesus' coming. In fact, Moses told the people in Exodus chapter 12, he says, the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, this month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family and slay it. You are to determine you're supposed to eat this, and then you have to get ready to travel. It's spring break time, and everybody is heading to Florida. Everybody. It is a glorious celebration. And there are some wonderful parallels from this entry, this holiday that God told the Israelites. You celebrate this every year, every year, every year. You celebrate this time, and it's called the Passover. Jesus was simply going to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. There, Christmas holiday. It's a 7-day feast. Now, like all holidays, you as well as I probably worry about gaining weight. Well, Jared, he doesn't worry about gaining weight. Look at him. Wish I could do that. It is so important for us to understand that it was a feast. Now, a little different. We knew what the meal was. The menu is the same. If I say Thanksgiving to you, what's on the menu?
Turkey.
If I say Christmas, what's on the menu? Leftover turkey. No. Ham. We know, don't we? Because we celebrate at different times. If we say 4th of July, what do you think? Hot dogs, brats, and a grill. We have a menu. They had a menu. And it was lamb, the best lamb of the crop. But they had some other things. They had lentils, but they couldn't cook with any yeast or anything that would make it rise, because yeast, it's easy for you to say, No leaven could be in the bread. It was a flat bread. What do you think of that? Have you ever had a pizza crust with no cheese? And then if it's cooled off and it's kind of... Well, they liked it. But that was part of their menu. But another part. By Mosaic law, they were not allowed to have any blood. But Jesus told them, Moses told them, to do something with the blood of the lamb. They couldn't break its bone. They couldn't crack its neck to kill it. They had to slaughter it with a slit of the neck, hang it upside down, and collect the blood in a basin. They had to put the blood on the door mantle and post, and then shut the door and enjoy Christmas. You could have your family, and they were given the choice. He says, you can slay a big lamb or a little lamb, depending on how big your family is. And they cut out the best pieces, and they cooked it over an open fire, and they baked, and they had all of the fixings. That was their holiday, and they were on their way to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. That's why Jesus was on the road. It was about an 11-mile trip for him as he began to go. But you see, the crowd was already there. Because across the country, everybody was celebrating Passover. Some then, like now, on our Christmas. We eliminate Christmas because it's easier to spell Xmas. The politically correct people today don't even want Christmas because it's a religious holiday. Well, there were people who were going to celebrate Passover who didn't understand the significance of the Passover. Remember, this is a couple thousand years after God instituted it to Moses. And so they were coming down, and they came out of the foothills of the mountains and come into Jerusalem. Jerusalem is called the City of Seven Hills, and it's a beautiful city. And so they were coming down, and Jesus told the disciples, you got to get ready for the Passover. Well, he told them to go get the donkey, but the other disciples went to find this room. Where are we going to put everybody? We got a big crowd, and we forgot to make reservations. And they were going to prepare. What did they have to do? They were going to have to kill the lamb. They were going to have to gut the lamb, drain the blood, and put it over the doorposts. That was all part of their feast. And many of them took short changes and said, well, we can't afford a lamb, we'll have a dove, we'll do all these other things. But I want you to understand what this feast was. And it's so important in what was present. So, we go back to Luke. I was in Exodus 12 there for a minute. And Mike, I know I had that clicker. It's still there? It's still there. Yeah, you put it, hid it from me. There was a grand parade. Kind of like Santa Claus is coming to town. But they didn't know it. They were looking forward to the party. The party, and when the priest would finally come out from the the holiest of holies and pronounce them guilt-free. It was a fun day. But look at this, back to Luke. Go to the village. Those who went ahead went and found it. And they found in verse 32, they untied the colt with its owners. And the owners asked, why are you untying? They said, the Lord needs it. They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. And along he went. People spread out their cloaks on the road. And palm branches in the other gospels, it records the fact that they spread palm branches and wave palm branches and so on. Near the place where the road goes to Mount Olives, the whole crowd began to rejoice. Now the first preparation was to get there, taking our Christmas pilgrimage, our Passover pilgrimage, and that was the parade. That's why there were people there. We over-dramatize and dramatize. Remember, Jesus had just a few days earlier, according to the Gospel of John, raised Lazarus from the dead. And so there was a natural interest in this Jesus who is coming down. But the crowd was there as they walked down the highway or the road, and they walked and they gathered and they gathered, and all of a sudden there's a guy coming, he's sitting on a donkey and coming down. And they were coming into the city, but they had to get the lamb. Little did they know that the lamb was on the donkey. The participants, who were they? In this great drama, it was the public, the whole scene. There were people, the Pharisees were there, they hated Jesus. Because what did Jesus do? Anytime he came to Jerusalem, or anytime he came to the synagogue, anytime he went there, what did he go? He went and taught. Because he was of the line of David, and because they classified him as a prophet, they let him into the courtyard, and even to the inner courtyard, not the highest and holiest, but where he taught. He taught the word of God, and people marveled and said, well, this man, he speaks with authority. What is this? Pharisees didn't like him, but they were there because they were going to Jerusalem too. Then there were the followers of Jesus, the disciples, the ones that went ahead and got the donkey for him, brought it back to him, put the cloak on his back. And there were the followers of Jesus who thought he was the best thing since sliced bread. They perhaps didn't understand all of the ramifications of what Jesus was about to do, but they followed him. They were loyal, and many of them didn't really understand. Oh, they knew about the Passover. They knew what was going to happen. They knew they were going to go into a family home, and they were going to go into a room, and they knew that they were going to spread blood on the doorpost. They knew that, but it was a ritual. It was part of Christmas. You have your Christmas rituals. Some of you celebrate Christmas Eve, and you do the same thing, have the same meal, do the same thing every time. And others on Christmas morning, some on Christmas Day. Everybody has their rituals, and they all did. But they followed Jesus. And then there's the in-betweens. A lot of people. A lot of people who never get much thought to the religiosity of Christmas. And a lot of people at Passover who never give much thought. It's just a party. We're going to celebrate. We're going shopping. And we're going to buy presents and give presents and going to rejoice and sing a little bit. And I suppose they had their Jewish jingles that they sang. And the participants included all of the above. The disciples, yeah, they kind of knew people, those who were closest to him knew people. Some people didn't like Jesus, some people did, but after all, he just raised Lazarus from the dead. Certainly, we're in no danger today. The participants were those of all different kinds. And there were even non-Jews who didn't give two hoots about Passover, but they liked the party. That's kind of like the world we live in today. So they went going, and then we get to, well, what's the purpose of this trip? The purpose is expressed down in verse 38 of our passage in Luke chapter 19, if you're wondering where I am. In Luke chapter 19, you read this verse. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. The Israelis looked forward to a king. They were a people in bondage. They didn't have their own country. Now, they did, but they had forfeited it, and they had been dispersed throughout the then known world. And they looked and looked, and they wanted a savior. They wanted a king, not a savior in the sense that he's going to save them from their sin, but a savior politically that would come in and overturn the rule of the Caesars and the Herods, that would overturn the rulings of the then known world, and that the Jewish people would once again not be in bondage and considered as slaves and inferior. They hope for that and the purpose of this. But look at this verse. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Can you think of another place that verse is used? Christmas. The angel sang, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill to all men." And so the similarities of the trip down the road into Jerusalem at Passover, what we call Holy Week, the trip down, the people were there, they were looking forward to the presentation of a king who will save their people, their nation. Kind of sounds like America today. Please, somebody, lower the gas prices. Please, somebody, save the economy. Please, somebody, get rid of corruption. Please, this is the guy, and he's coming down the road, and the purpose was to fulfill the biblical prophecies that God had made way back to Abraham, when he chose Abraham to be the father of many nations. And he says, "In you and your progeny, I will bless the world. I will save the world." And the purpose was to present this king. But he didn't come as a king. He came on the foal of, on the back of a donkey. Why? Because Jesus, while he is the king, he came to come as a servant. One of the things that I found in the 5 decades of ministry is that people are mesmerized by leadership. Everybody's got to have a leader. And we go to leadership training seminars, and we read leadership books, and we read all things about leadership. But Jesus didn't even talk about leadership, ever. What did he talk about? Service. Serve me. He talked about serving. So he came in on the back of a donkey. Why didn't he come in on a stallion? Whenever you see Caesars, pictures of Caesars who thought themselves to be God, or even Pharaoh way back in Passover time, or even any of the leaderships, what did they want to present? Strength and leadership. I will lead you people to the Mecca. But he came as a servant. He came to bring peace on earth. But peace on earth can't start until there's peace in here. It's so important that we understand that. And then he exhibited the power. What's the power? If we would sing the song, "Would you be free from your burden of sin?" There is what?
Power
in the blood. Jesus came to present. Now he knew. He knew walking on the foal of a donkey is not what the political people wanted, the military people wanted. But he knew where the real power was. The real power in your life and mine is the blood. Why? Because the blood brings forgiveness. The blood brings forgiveness. You can't have forgiveness without the shedding of blood. In fact, Scripture tells us that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. And without the forgiveness of sins, folks, there is no hope. We are just doomed. Well, as he approached, it says, when he got near Jerusalem, this servant, it says in verse 41, if you, even you, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the star city, he wept over it. There's only two places that Jesus wept. This is one of them. He wept over his people. What a mess they've made of their life. What a mess they've made of their world. And yes, that included the Pharisees, and it included the bystanders, and it included the disciples, and it included the Gentiles and those who ruled over them. And he wept over them. He also wept when he came to Lazarus' tomb just a few days previously. The only two times we have record that Jesus wept. Because he feels the pain that we feel. The servant always feels the pain. He could identify with us. Well, as you move on through the story, he exhibited the power later. Whoops, I'm not done yet. We come to this, some of the Pharisees looked at him and says, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." Even some of the Pharisees who there said, "Rebuke your disciples." They can't be saying this because Jesus is the servant. We're looking for the king. But the truth is, we are looking for the Savior. The whole thing about Holy Week or Palm Sunday, it began the 7-day process of the celebration of the fulfillment of Jewish prophecy. At the first Passover, it was just deliverance from Egypt. But through the years, it began, then it went from Egypt to Rome, the Roman Empire, which had great power. And now in our world today, we too must look not for the political, not for the military, not for the economic, but the Savior of all mankind. Now, they were cheering. And the cheers were deserved. But he came to be the Savior. And the power was in the blood of the Savior. The same power that saved them in the Exodus from Egypt, the blood of the Lamb. Jesus said, in fact, when they introduced, John the Baptist introduced Jesus to them in the very first days of his ministry, John the Baptist said, "Look, behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world." And how did he do that? With the power of his blood. No, we don't spread it upon the doorpost. We don't put it across the mantle. Put it in our heart. The Passover week is a celebration of the power of the blood. So where do we go from here on this wonderful, wonderful celebration? This day, Palm Sunday, it's a beautiful Sunday. I would like to think that on that first Palm Sunday, I don't think they called it that, that first entry of Jesus, I'd like to think it was a beautiful sunny day. And they rode down the hill and got into the valleys and then through the eastern gate where he entered Jerusalem. They came in and Jesus was weeping and he looked, oh, what a mess. Just receive me. You know the story. Now, we're not having a Good Friday service this year, but you know the story. By Friday, the Pharisees had already rejected him early on. The middle of the group, the recipients and participants in a great raucous party, they had turned on him. And the disciples ran and fled. Within hours, they took off and left him. And there was the servant now, not the king. Only a servant could shed his blood for the servants of the world. And let me tell you, every person in this room and every person within my hearing is a slave to something. Unfortunately, for most, it's sin. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Jesus was willing, and hence, later in the week, he was tried, beaten, scorned, stripped, and hung on a cross. But the story doesn't end, because there's power. Just like in the first Passover, the blood was shed and the Passover angel went through the camps in Egypt. And those who had the blood left Egypt free men, no longer slaves. And if you will let the blood of Jesus apply in your heart and life, not only can you be free from the burden of sin, but you can have power and victory over the presence of sin. Which crowd are we? Are we part of the Pharisees who kind of poo-hoo all this Jesus? He's not all you say he is. I prayed to him once and nothing happened. Well, we've all felt like that. I prayed to him and I prayed and prayed and prayed and he didn't answer my prayer. You prayed the wrong prayer. Usually, we're not praying to God. We're asking God to do something. We're telling him what we want him to do. How about just asking him to do what he wants to do? And that's to give you victory. Because there's power in the blood. Then there's that middle crowd. Yeah, you know, I'll go to church if it's a good Sunday. I'm surprised, honestly surprised, churches don't fill up on Sundays when it's rainy and cold and freezing because there's nothing else to do. That would be that middle crowd. But they were there for the party. Folks, we have a good time here. You know, you think that? I know the jokes are bad. I don't know if it's operator error or they're just bad. I don't know. But isn't it fun to laugh? Isn't it fun to come and hug? Shake hands? You know, I've learned a couple of things. I'm not going to get into a handshaking contest with Andy. His hands is bigger and stronger and he likes, you know, he's a man. You see, that middle group is where most of us find ourselves. And the disciples, I think most of us, if we'd sit here today and I'd say, would you deny Jesus? Most of us would be just like Peter, say, oh no, Lord, I'll never deny you. I'll never deny you. But after Jesus came into the crowd, into the city with Jesus as Peter and the disciples followed him into Jerusalem and then the crowd began to turn a little bit and now they've got Jesus in the courtyard and they're trying him. It says in Mark that the disciples, Peter was the boastful one. Oh, I'll never leave him. But they all, it says in Mark, they all forsook him and fled. What does that mean? Probably until the power of the blood has been applied, there was no power. And without power, there is no hope. Which crowd are we? I would like to think I would be strong enough to say, Lord, I won't deny you. But how many times have we not spoken up when somebody talks about our Savior? Does it bother you when somebody says, Jesus Christ? Does that bother you? It should. God. Really? And we don't say anything? I can listen to people use four-letter words. I always said my mother told me that swearing is simply the efforts of an idiot trying to express himself forcibly. Well, you need a bigger vocabulary. But I can live with that. I can live with the F-words and I can all of the other cursing. Doesn't it bother you when they swear in Jesus' name? Maybe we can say something. God won't damn that. You're already condemned. Ooh. Jesus wouldn't do that. Folks, there are some things that Christians, and sometimes I think, well, people will think I'm a religious fanatic. I'm a nut. Which crowd are we? That's the decision you have to make. We have to make together. Which crowd are we? But I want you to always remember as he came into the city, riding on the back of a donkey, he came as our servant. And the servant came to save in the power of the blood. Oh, how he loves you and me. Let's pray. Father, we come to this time recognizing that somewhere in that mass of people we find ourselves. We perhaps are the Pharisaical folks who nitpick and want to apply the rigid law of truth to life as if that would help. Perhaps we're of the disciples who are following the close associates of Jesus and yet still run with fear. Probably we're in the middle. We're here for the party. Let's see what happens. But let us remember this morning that Jesus loves us, gave himself for us willingly to be our servant, our Savior, and our hope. Lord, we trust you as we learn how you love us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand as we sing, "Oh, how he loves you and me." Don't forget, there's food downstairs. Oh, how he loves you and me. Jesus, now and forever. Amen.